Guys, there are some powerful, powerful verses that we've got to look at in the Bible when we talk about the subject of love, freedom, risk. Mm. And that really describe what happened, not only here on planet Earth, but also what has taken place in the context of heaven and the conflict that began there and has now come down to this planet. I'm thinking of Revelation chapter 12. I'm thinking of Ezekiel 28. I know we've looked at some of these Bible verses briefly, but I think we really need to dig in. We really need to find some of the key elements.
Where do you
want to
start?
I think we should start in Revelation 12.
All right, let's do it.
Now, only because that is my favorite book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 12, it basically lays out in verses 7 through 9 this war that broke out in heaven. I'll just read the verses. Revelation chapter 12, 7 through 9. And it says here, war broke out in heaven, and Michael and his angels fought with the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought, but they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. So that great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Powerful. That's huge,
verses,
isn't it?
Powerful verses.
Oh, so much there.
This brings together not only the fact that this earth is engaged in a war and a conflict, but that this war actually began in heaven. Now, this war isn't like the kind of wars that we have today on planet Earth. You know, we've got tanks and grenades and bombs and missiles and machine guns. This war is different. This war is a war that could be described as political.
Yeah.
It is a war of words. It's a war of ideas. It's a conflict of principles. In fact, the Bible describes that in many other places, the principles and powers that are in conflict in relation to not only heaven, but planet Earth and what's going on this planet.
Okay, James, you're saying this is a political war, and really that's in the text.
Yes.
In chapter 12, verse 7, the first verse you read of Revelation, it says war broke out in heaven. The Greek word that the Apostle John chose to employ here, guys, is polemos, from which we get words, well, first of all, like poles, like the North Pole, South Pole, two poles on a battery, a positive and a negative. It's the idea of polemic. It's the idea of two divided or opposite ends of a spectrum or of ideas. Polemos is a word from which we get words like politics. When we witness a political battle in American culture, a political war.
Or any culture.
Or any culture, at least nowadays, the opponents, you don't find, you know, Obama challenging the person who's running against him to a duel or to a sword fight or even to an arm wrestling match. These guys don't engage in a physical battle. When you watch a political war occur, when the presidential debate, for example, is taking place, it's two guys with suits and ties standing behind pulpits, behind podiums. And what are they shooting at one another? James
words.
Said words.
Ideas,
concepts. And really those ideas and concepts come down to something very basic. Each of the opponents is basically representing what they stand for and what they purport to be bringing to the people as a superior form of governance. And then in our political system, it always goes in the direction of character assassination. So the words that are being shot back or forth are words that are claiming to represent, I'm representing myself as a political candidate, and this guy, you don't want him governing, because I'll tell you some things about him, and the effort is to lower the estimation of the people's opinion in the opinion polls, as we call them, so that the political war can be won by the opponent.
Well, smear campaign.
It's a smear campaign. It's a propaganda campaign. And that's what's going on here in the universe. When the Bible says war or polemos broke out in heaven, it means a political battle erupted in the angelic community or the angelic society.
I want to just add something. I love everything you said there, and I think you did a very good job articulating it. Basically, the two candidates, or in this case, the war that breaks out between God and the dragon, is two basic views of reality. That's what the two candidates see the world differently, and they're essentially saying, my way of viewing the world is a superior way to viewing the world than my opponents.
Yeah.
So you have not just on issues, but those issues are a reflection of just totally different ways of viewing the nature of reality. And as we're going to discover here, the dragon or Satan's view of reality and view of God is such that he sees God as overbearing, he sees God as controlling, he sees God as exercising an unwarranted sovereignty and control.
And restrictions,
exactly. So what we're going to see here is that the question, at least in this particular political debate, this isn't an American political debate or another country's political debate, this is the data over which they're debating here is the nature of God's character and governance.
Yeah. Yes. In the text itself, before we move from Revelation 12, just don't want to lose this, there's another word that is used in the text that tells us the nature of this warfare. Mm-hmm. War broke out in heaven, polemos, but then in verse 9 it says that Satan deceives the whole world. Mm-hmm. So the word deceives is employed, right?
Deception.
So, yeah, deception. This isn't, again, the devil isn't sharpening a knife to attack. He's not loading a gun to attack. Mm-hmm. He's not shooting laser beams out of his fingertips.
Darth Vader, like, zzz.
No, it's nothing like that. It's deception. He's spinning a web of ideas in order to catch his prey.
This is like the movie, man. It's like the original epic. You know, like Lord Byron said, truth is stranger than fiction. Mm-hmm. It's just like, this is real. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And this is what happened when we were talking about in the Garden of Eden. The God created this world and gave it to mankind, Adam and Eve. Mm-hmm. And as we read the account there in Genesis chapter 3, the serpent, Satan, the devil, came to Adam and Eve in the garden and started spinning these lies, trafficking these lies about God, about his character, putting forth that God was restrictive, that God was limiting their ability, that they would be like him. And so this world became the center of the controversy. You read about this a little bit further on here in Revelation chapter 12. It talks about how the devil has come down unto you. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and sea for the devil. Verse 12 of Revelation 12. For the devil has come down to you having great wrath because he knows his time is short, or he has just a short time. So in the controversy, this earth has become the center because we bought into the lie in the Garden of Eden.
Yeah.
We started to believe some of the things that the devil was trafficking about God, about his character, about love, about freedom, about the restrictiveness that Satan was trying to project on the character of God.
There's a part of that verse you didn't read, maybe on purpose, the first part of the verse, or did you read it and I missed it, where it says, therefore rejoice,
I skipped it.
O heavens, and you who dwell in them, which gives the cosmic perspective.
Yes.
That is to say that
heaven is involved.
Yeah, heaven is involved, but it's not heaven as in stars and suns and galaxies. Heavens and you who dwell in them. So the heavens, as we talked about in a previous conversation, the heavens are populated, and this world is a theater, and in this world something's happening. There's a great controversy, and the heavens
are now rejoicing.
The populated heavens are rejoicing that Satan was cast out of their realm. Mm-hmm. But woe to the inhabitants of the earth, and they're still engaged in watching the great controversy unfold. So that one verse takes in heaven and earth, right? The whole cosmic war between good and evil.
But I think it's really important here as we build this theme and develop this theme to understand that it's not a physical casting out that they're rejoicing over. It is the casting out of the ideas, the casting out of the trafficking, the casting out of the misrepresentation of the character of God. The heavens are rejoicing not because the devil's come down to this earth and they're, oh, thank goodness he's down there and he's not here anymore.
Geographically, he's been removed.
Right.
Yeah.
They're rejoicing because it's clear. It's something has become clear in their minds and hearts about his accusations concerning God.
The popular vote has swung.
Oh, that's a great way to say it.
Yes. And in the commercials, you know, this message has been approved by God. And those commercials have been persuasive, and the popular vote has still
been seen. And now that it's moved from heaven to earth, to follow the metaphor of politics straight through, the popular vote has been won in the heavenly society, and now there's a voting booth on earth, and it's called the Tree of the Knowledge of Good and Evil.
I like
that. And they're invited to the voting booth. Adam and Eve, humanity is invited to vote.
There's more than one candidate, and so this is the drama.
Could we then, Revelation 12 is built very much on Genesis 3, because you have the dragon and the serpent being yes. cast out, I think it would be, even though we've been there before, it would be well for us to at least go back to Genesis 3 and reestablish the nature of that deception. The deception revolved around certain things about God, about his character. Here we're saying two political candidates, one is saying this, one is saying that. Well, we have biblical data as to what the serpent was saying. Yeah. We know what his line was.
But everything you're about to read is on earth.
But it gives us.
But that's the beautiful thing, is that we are drawn to the scene on earth in the garden, because that gives us a picture about what happened in realms that we don't have.
Yes, good point.
We don't have access to those realms, and so God has outlined what happened on earth, and that's our reference point. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's how it went down up there, the way that it went. So the controversy simply transferred.
Yeah,
to
that's
earth.
Excellent.
Yeah, totally. Oh.
Yeah. So Genesis 3, David.
Genesis 3.
Well, let's go back there and just summarize what transpired at the fall of mankind. Yeah. I'll just initiate it by calling attention to verse 1, that the serpent approaches with cunning, with deception, with deceptive intent.
Yeah. The Bible does not often introduce Satan as a super powerful being. There is certainly a sense in which he's powerful relative to, say, to those of us at this table, but relative to God, his power is negligible. I mean, he's a created being. God could just snap him out of existence. So our concern about Satan and our fear of him, I'm just using that, our concern about him should not be that he's strong and that he's muscular and that he's terrible and that he's frightening. It's that he's subtle.
Okay.
There's a subility. There's a kind of, scripture is introduced that way over and over
again. So he's not the guy with the pitchfork and with the...
Is that subtle?
With the horns.
No, in other words, the caricature that we invent of Satan, the caricatures that we've invented of Satan are most pleasing to him.
That's right. It serves his purposes.
Perfectly.
I think something you said gets to the real heart of the key issue in this cosmic war. You said that God could just snap him out of existence. Well, a lot of people actually wonder, well, why not? I mean, if he's the enemy and he's done all these dastardly things and we're suffering under his influence, why didn't God just snap him out of existence the moment that he began to rebel? Why not? You see millions, billions of angels. Lucifer begins to level accusations against the character of God and to spin his web of deception. Why wouldn't God just say, listen, what Lucifer is saying about me is false. Don't talk about me like that anymore. Snap out of existence.
That
a
would,
puff of
that
smoke,
would bring us
gone.
Right back to our theme of love requires freedom, requires risk. In other words, if God is love and that love requires freedom, and that freedom involves this choice that we have to love or not to have, and so that we...
To love or not to love.
To love or not to love, excuse me. And so then we exercise that choice. We say, well, I think I will choose not to love God.
Snap.
Oh.
Zap.
What?
That's force.
Well, try to imagine the picture. This is what I was trying to just picture in your mind.
That's Kim Jong-il right there. That's Kim Jong-il.
Yeah, election. Picture in your mind. All the angels are standing there. God says, what he's saying about me isn't true. Zap, he's gone. In that next moment, what are all the angels thinking?
Yeah.
Don't
go
challenge
contrary.
God. Don't say anything different. I think we better watch our P's and Q's because we're dealing here with a kind of power that's all about zapping.
You know, I was in Vancouver, Canada, and I was interacting with this ex-drug addict who was recovering, and he would come to these meetings, these Bible study meetings we would have, and anytime the subject of God and evil would come up, he would just like freak out, and he would begin to curse and swear. And I remember I would always have to gently walk up, grab him, take him outside, and just say, cool it. And his main issue was, if I was God, I would shoot the devil in the head tonight. He would always say that. If I was God, I would just blow him away. And I remember thinking about that and thinking, man, I get where he's coming from. Like, I get it. You know, he's perplexed. And at some point, the conversation led to, I asked him, if God were to shoot the devil dead tonight, would that solve God's problem? Would that, tomorrow morning, okay, the devil, he's on the ground, his brains are across the floor. Tomorrow morning, are there no prostitutes? Tomorrow morning, is there no drug addicts under the bridge? Tomorrow morning, is everything perfect on earth? Is evil gone? And he thought about it first. He said, I guess not. I said, the problem that God has is not with the guy with the pitchfork and the horns. Mm. God's issue is floating around between your ears. Mm. The issue God is dealing with is in our minds, because the voice in Genesis has introduced these false concepts mm-hmm. of God, and that's what he's up against. And at the end of the day, in the last conversation, we read Philippians 2. Tell me how you feel about this. Tell me if I'm onto something. In Philippians 2, this idea of the Messiah coming to this world and representing God, at the end of that it says, every knee will bow of those in heaven, on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So check this out. The problem that God has is not that his muscles are not big enough to remove sin from the world. What God wants is for sin to bow the knee, for evil to bow the knee. So in the end,
by way of evidence?
By way of the fact that God's character would have been, what's the word I'm looking for?
Not vindicated, justified,
vindicated.
Exonerated.
Yeah, in the end. And what we've been saying here, that God is not going to win the war, what did you say? Not by force.
But not by position, but by influence.
Yeah, by the virtue of his character. And so in the end, evil would be allowed to play its full course out so that the entire universe would then see, okay, yeah, I'm voting for candidate number one. And in that sense, God would have conquered evil because of the virtue of his character. So I think that's important to highlight. It's not an issue of power. It's not an issue of just this person called Satan. The issue is also in the deceptions that have been introduced into our own minds.
And I think I love what you say there, Jeffrey. I think we've also, at times, we overplay Satan's influence in the world. Mm. Satan was the originator of sin, but we are now participants in sin, participants in rebellion, every bit as much as the angels or Satan. In
other words, we got the virus.
He pushed the snowball down the hill. He got it going, but we're now caught up in the wake of that, such that, and I've said the same thing too, if the devil were to die tonight by some means, whether supernatural or natural, whatever, hypothetically here, we know that that's not going to happen, that doesn't solve the problems of the world, because I've got devil-like thinking, selfish thinking between my ears, and so do you, and so do you, and so do billions of people, and so do the fallen angels. So the problem, you're exactly correct in identifying, you know, the solution will be proportionate and commensurate with the diagnosis. And the diagnosis is not, it's not an issue of power. It's an issue of persuasion and of conviction and of love.
Jeffrey, you mentioned, and David, you just mentioned that the issue God is dealing with is between our ears. We want to share the story of a lady that we met in Africa, James and I did, and her name is Barbara. And she has an incredible story, and it all happened between her ears. It all happened. She encountered ideas about God, concepts about God, insights to God's love, and it radically impacted her thinking. And the weapons, if you will, that were used were words on paper. Literature was given to her, and it radically transformed the way she thinks
Hallelujah.
And feels about God. So let's look at Barbara's story.
Amen. I was really looking for happiness because, you know, teenagers, they think happiness is in drinking beer, clubbing. Well, I became an alcoholic when I was very young, at the age of 16. A lot of times when I go clubbing, I used to drink a lot of alcohol. Different men used to take me out. When I'm drunk, I go with them. When I used to club and I used to smoke and do all of those bad things, I didn't find happiness at all. When I became in contact with the VOPs, I became a changed person. I started going through them, started studying them, answering questions. That's when I knew that the bad life I had was not good at all. As I was reading, I came across a very important verse, Hebrews chapter 9, verse 28. That verse touched me. It says, Jesus Christ was once a sacrifice to take the sins of many, and he will appear again for the second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to everyone who is waiting for him. And definitely, I'm one of those people who is waiting for him.
To partner with Lightbearers in spreading the gospel, visit us online at lightbearers.org or call us toll-free at 877-585-1111. You can also write to us at Lightbearers, 37457 Jasper Lowell Road, Jasper, Oregon, 97438.
So the devil's obviously not the guy with the pitchfork and the horns. And we've been talking about the fact that God's problem is far more profound than what we often make it out to be. That's right. Oversimplify. Mm-hmm. If I were God, I would zap him. And the reality is that the world is a messed up place. And I made a comment in our last conversation about the fact that were the devil to die tonight, tomorrow, the world would remain the same. And I mentioned the prostitute or the drug dealer under the bridge. But in mentioning these different people, I'm talking about the victimization. Mm-hmm. Is that even a word?
Yeah.
Victimization.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The victimization of the world. That these are victims. Mm-hmm. And we're all part of this world. And yeah. Genesis chapter 3 actually records
Let me just say, Jeffrey, before here. You look at Genesis 3, that I appreciate that clarification on a very personal level. That when we mention the prostitutes, the drug addicts under the bridge, whatever that kind of language, I appreciate that clarification a lot because my mother was a drug addict. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She was never homeless, but she was a drug addict, and I knew as a kid, although I didn't have the language to wrap around victimization, I knew. Check this out. This was amazing. I learned this when I was a teenager. I didn't even know this, but. But when my mom and dad, my biological father, separated, my mom explained to me later that the reason they separated is because my mom gave him an ultimatum. The ultimatum was that they were young and they were, you know, partying and whatever, and then here comes this baby, that's me, and she tells him, I don't want to continue this life of, you know, well, mainly him. She wasn't really into drugs, she was socially drinking. But she wasn't a drug addict. But my biological father was a heavy drug user from what she told me. And she said, you know, we have a baby now and you need to stop this. We need to, you know, we need to settle down and have a family. We need to be responsible now. And he just kept saying, yeah, but then continuing on as a party animal. And my mom left my biological father in order to move away from drugs and alcohol. Then my mom married a guy, my stepfather, and he was an alcoholic or became one along the way and was abusive. And then my mom became an alcoholic and a drug addict in order to cope with the abuse and the pain that was continually being put upon her. I watched my mom.
It was a coping mechanism.
Yeah, it was a coping mechanism. So she was, Jeffrey, she was, you know, a sinner like all of us, but she was a victim of what was coming her way, and she coped with it by becoming my mom. You know, I cringe to say it, but my mom was an alcoholic and a drug addict. Praise God, the last 3 years of her life, she completely stopped using drugs and alcohol and became a vibrant
Amen.
Christian. She loved
Hallelujah.
The Lord. Yeah, but yeah. So I appreciate that a lot. I appreciate that clarification because all of that's in my history.
So the story of Genesis 3 is, in many ways, the story of the first deception and the first victimization. But it's not a victimization of control. Mm. It's not of power or of strength. It's of manipulation, psychological manipulation.
That's a great way to say
and
it.
We've been there, haven't we? Yeah. Mm-hmm. We sort of talked about the three parts, the tripod of deception. Mm-hmm. And the first there was where Satan, the serpent, said to Eve, has God really said you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Suggesting that there was this vast horizon of restriction, but only a modicum of freedom, where in fact the opposite was true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
God had given huge freedom of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but just this one don't. So suggesting that God is unclear and that he's withholding and that he's restrictive. Mm-hmm. He then transitions. Now, this is just review for us, but we're talking about a war. And if we want to know what happened up there, this is a really good insight as to his M.O., Satan's M.O. Then he says, in the day that you eat of that tree, you're not going to die. Mm. Translation, God has lied to you. God is not trustworthy. He doesn't love you. He's trying to control you or manipulate you for purposes, nefarious implied, of his own. Mm. And then the third leg of the tripod is where he just comes right out and says, this is what it's about. Mm-hmm. He knows that in the day that you eat of this tree, you'll be like him. You'll be like God. Mm. So you have the sort of God is a withholder and restrictive. He's unclear. You have God is untrustworthy. He doesn't love you. He's manipulating you. And the reason is he's self-serving. He's looking out for number one. Mm. All of this, and this was our big point a couple discussions ago, and I hope our listeners will get this. Mm-hmm. All of that psychological attack and all of that psychological reorientation comes before the physical act of sinning.
Yeah.
The point is
it's
not
crucial
the
to get taking that,
the that's the effect.
That's right.
That's the effect.
That's the effect.
Yeah, we have another insight to the psychological nature of this warfare and the fact that it was a complete distortion of the character of God that was deposited in human thoughts and feelings. We have another insight to that in Job 1. Because here we have verse 6. Just listen to this and see if you agree that there's something more here than really meets the eye on the surface. It says, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, in verse 6, and Satan came also among them. So the picture is Satan is now showing up in this heavenly conclave, this heavenly parliament, this meeting before God. Mm-hmm. So they're all together, and the devil proceeds to level an accusation, and here's where it goes. The Lord said to Satan, where do you come from? Satan said, I come from earth. That's verse 7. Verse 8, the Lord said to Satan, but have you considered my servant Job? Mm. So God points to a human being as if to say, he's my true representative on earth. You're here purporting to represent planet earth. But I value what I see taking place in Job, and he's my true man. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then the devil begins his accusation, and he says in verse 9, does Job fear or reverence or serve God for nothing? Question mark again. He's into this question mark on God, and he says, does Job fear God for nothing? And then he says, have you not made a hedge about him, around him, his household, around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. What the devil basically just said is God, you have bought Job's loyalty and affection and trust and whatever you got from Job, you've purchased with stuff, with material blessings. But if you take all the stuff away, the material blessings away, he'll curse you because Job isn't serving you because of something that's intrinsically worthy of being served that he sees in you. He's basically prostituting himself to you. He's giving service to you.
Yeah. That's good, though.
He's serving you because you've bought him off. So two motives are in contrast here. God is claiming that Job and I have something going on, and the basis of it is love,
loyalty
and love and trust. And the devil is saying, no, that's not what's going on. What's going on here is that you're self-serving and he's self-serving and you've got an arrangement going where you're scratching one another's backs.
Okay, now that is awesome. That is so true,
heavy.
But I got to speak to this now. This is not just a conversation between between Satan and God, because if that were the case, God could then just leverage his omniscience and say, I really know what's going on, and you don't really know what's going on by virtue of the fact that I'm God, and you're not omniscient. However, the other players here are those listening in who don't have the gift that God has, the natural innate ability of knowing the truth. So now an accusation has been levied, and God here can either grab Satan by the neck and wring his neck and say, what I'm saying is true, that's an option, his power, or just snap him out of existence as we've talked about, or he can look around and say, okay, this is an accusation.
There's a jury here.
There's a jury here, so let's see. And the rest of the book of Job is the playing out of God answering the accusation of Satan, not with his might, but by allowing evil to play its course and seeing where Job's loyalty really lies. Is it because of the goodies? Mm-hmm. Is it because of the stuff? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or is it because of who God is himself?
Philip Yancey calls this the wager.
The wager.
Yeah, this is a wager between God and the devil, not in the simplistic sense of a bet, but in the sense of there are two claims being made, let's play it out. Well, let's see what the truth of the matter actually is.
Isn't it fascinating to you that God's reply in his defense is pointing to a human being and saying, check out what's happening in the war that's raging in his heart and his mind, and check out who's who's on the throne of his heart and mind. Yeah. So God's defense in court is by pointing to the human race and saying, you should consider that little piece of data right there.
Okay,
that's powerful.
I've got to bring something here. I hope this works. I want you to tell me if you think this is awesome or not.
We will.
Okay. Is there anything in between, David? It's awesome or not? Is it okay to say
I'm learning,
that's all right?
I'm learning a lesson
from Jeffrey. I don't know if it's going to be as awesome as that illustration I shared the other day.
Okay, so here's you mentioned earlier, Ty, that God could have just snapped Satan out of existence, and we just said here, you know, God could have wrung Satan's neck, so to speak. Okay. And you said that there would have just been a puff of smoke, but then all the angels would have said, oh, but we'll serve God out of fear that we don't want to be snapped out of existence, rather from love. Okay, but we have to remember we're dealing with an omnipotent being here, a being who has the resources of every possible option available to him. So he could have done something even more subtle and persuasive, and that is this. He could have just thought Satan out of existence and then, with his power,
I know where you're going.
He could have removed
our memory
any
of
memory
it.
Of Satan so that, now here's where this gets really amazing, so that the angels would be blissfully unaware, there would be no question of loyalty. Now watch this, we've got these magnets at the table here to play with. So it would be a little bit like this. Okay, let's just say that behind the scene, I'm gonna take these heavier magnets here and I'm gonna put them under the table so that I can you get a shot of that, Jim? So that I can move, but if you didn't know that I had the magnets under the table, it would look like this thing is moving on its own, right? So if God goes behind the scenes, so to speak, which he can do for any one of us, right now he can make you think any thought you want. He can remove any memory that you've had, any affection or any part of your personality he can manipulate. So he can just go behind the scenes and do whatever he wants.
And nobody would know the difference.
Now let me ask you this question.
Except,
here's the question, and you're already onto it, but I'm going to ask it anyway for our listeners. Who is the only one who would know what's really going on? The only one who would know.
God.
Okay, so who gets gypped then? Who's the one that gets gypped? God himself knows that if he begins to manipulate in that absolutely subtle and undetectable way, the one who suffers is God. And what he longs for are real relationships with real people, which require real love and real freedom and real risk. God could manipulate the circumstances to where it looks to everybody in a robotic fashion as if all is well.
Except for him.
Yeah. The one that gets
and
robbed.
And that's a price too high to pay.
It's too high.
Not only does God get robbed, but another way of saying it is, if God were to
that's awesome.
Okay,
woo!
On the continuum, on the spectrum from awesome to not, that's awesome.
That was amazing. Okay, that was amazing.
It's a good illustration.
I honestly didn't know where you were going.
Not only does God get, as you said, gypped, not only does he get robbed, but God in himself would be submitting to a value system or an exercise of principles and character that's completely contrary to who God is.
That was Jeffrey's point in our last conversation. Not only
does he not want to,
he just wouldn't. That's not
he
the
couldn't,
kind
yeah.
of a virtuoso violinist. Yeah. If I picked up the violin, it would be a disaster. But a virtuoso violinist wouldn't pick up the violin and purposefully, intentionally play. No, naturally, what's going to flow out of him or her, it's going to be beautiful, right? You wouldn't intentionally play something that sounded discordant and off key and disharmonious and out of tune when you have the capacity to do something grand and beautiful.
Especially if you love beauty.
You know, did we ever, in an earlier conversation, we had mentioned several times that we wanted to go to Psalm 27:4. Did we ever
get
there?
We never did.
Well, this is not a bad place to go there, at least to just mention it. Mm-hmm. David basically says there in the Psalm, I'll just read it, Ty, and you can launch off on this or I can launch off on this, because both of us were saying, man, we've got to bring that up. We've got to bring that up. And this is a great place. Psalm 27, verse 4, one thing I have desired of the Lord, and that I will seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, that I may be in fellowship with him all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Mm-hmm. God is beautiful, and I love the idea that God is not just God, strong, mighty, omnipotent, omniscient, omnibenevolent, and all of the attributes, the omnis. God is beautiful. Yeah. Mm. And as a beautiful God of love and art and creativity, he's not going to be satisfied with the little
doing anything under the table,
right?
And that's funny that we would say it that way, under the table.
Yeah, that implies deception.
Mm-hmm. Man, that's so
isn't
good.
That something?
I'm going to
use
that.
What we're suggesting here is that God is a God of full disclosure. Mm-hmm. He's above the table. Mm-hmm. He's playing out all his attributes right before the universe to behold, before humanity and angels, so that we can all look in, and this just came to my mind, Isaiah 5. God, in the local historical sense, is saying, hey, this is everything I've done for Israel. They're like a vineyard that I've planted. Mm. I've planted this vineyard. I pulled out the stones, and I've cultivated the ground, and I've planted Israel as a beautiful grape vine. But it brought forth bad grapes. And then God says something interesting.
Yeah, I love this.
He says, judge between me and my vineyard, between me and Israel. Judge between me and them.
Is there anything more
that I could have done for Israel that I have not done? So God is inviting judgment.
He invites inquiry.
And he's aiming for full disclosure. He wants everything on the table, nothing under the table.
Authenticity is not an option with God.
That's right.
It's not an option.
That's right.
I think if everyone's cool with this, I'd like to go to Ezekiel 28, which is a passage that we've been to before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But in saying that God is a God of beauty, he's a God that's above the table, he's above board, he's a God of authenticity, we have to then realize that in this conflict, Satan has tools in his toolbox. Mm-hmm. He has resources that he can use that are not available to God. Mm-hmm. Right? In other words, deception, innuendo, insinuation,
coercion.
Manipulation, coercion. And we see this.
Go there fast. We got 1 minute before the break.
Well, then let's just go afterward because we want to spend some time there.
Yeah, well, Ezekiel 28, though, we could spend some real time there. Just go and get us started there at least.
Yeah.
And then we do need to take a break because of the required
schedule. Yeah, no, I get that.
All right.
But let's be sure
to come back.
That we come back because there's this, as you're aware, this weird little word that sort of shows up there. In the King James, it's like merchandise. It's merchandise.
Oh, is it? Okay.
And New King James is trafficking. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it's just like, what? Where? Yeah. What is that word doing there?
And in the newer New King James Version, they actually dealt with it by calling it trading.
Trading.
Yeah.
And in the break, I'll look up some other translations and see what that word is rendered as.
So basically what we've come to so far in this conversation is that the war that we're engaged in is a political war that's taking place in the hearts and minds of human beings. Mm-hmm. The basic issue in the great war between good and evil is misrepresentation of the character of God versus the truth about the character of God. Mm-hmm. And that's the playing field. That's the landscape upon which this war is occurring.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
A Light in Zambia is a moving video documentary that traces the stories of five amazing African men and women who encountered Christ through the powerful medium of gospel literature. To receive your free copy, call 877-585-1111 or write to Lightbearers, 37457 Jasper Lowell Road, Jasper, Oregon, 97438. Once again, to receive your free copy of A Light in Zambia, call 877-585-1111 or write to Lightbearers, 37457 Jasper Lowell Road, Jasper, Oregon, 97438. Simply ask for the Zambia DVD.
We ended our last conversation where I was really hoping to get to Ezekiel 28, mm-hmm. but we had time constraints. But now we're good. So let's go take a look at this verse I was mentioning that sort of shows up. It's an unusual word. And what I want to do so that we can appreciate just how unusual it is just sort of read some of Ezekiel 28 just very quickly in context so that when we get to that word, we can say, well, that is kind of odd. So I'm just going to read beginning in verse 12. We've been here before. It says, Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyre and say thus to him, thus says the Lord God. You are the seal of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. This is describing the fall of Lucifer. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the sardius, topaz, diamond, the beryl, onyx, and jasper, sapphire, turquoise, and emerald with gold. The workmanship of your timbrels and pipes was prepared for you on the day that you were created. You were the anointed cherub who covers. I established you. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. You were perfect in your ways from the day that you were created till iniquity was found in you. Okay, so far so good, right? Mm. We not so good. It's actually so terrible. But in terms of our understanding, this is the fall of Lucifer. And now listen to this. Next verse, verse 16. By the abundance of your trading, you became filled with violence within and you sinned. Therefore, I cast you as a profane thing out of the mountain of God. I destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the fiery stones. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I laid you before kings that they might gaze at you. Mm. You defiled your sanctuaries by the multitude of your iniquities. Here it is again, by the iniquity of your trading. Mm. And we could continue to read on here. But isn't it interesting where God is basically raising this series of accusations? You were perfect, you were perfect, you were perfect. And then iniquity was found in you. And you exalted your heart by reason of your splendor. And in the midst of all of these sort of understandable accusations, mm-hmm. God says, you know what it was? It was your trading.
Wow.
It was your trafficking. Mm-hmm. One of the verses there in the King James, it was your merchandise.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, I remember the first time I read that, I thought, what? You know,
what's so he it's trading?
Like, yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. Like you were selling something. But what was Satan selling? He wasn't selling widgets, mm-hmm. right? He wasn't selling trinkets.
Drugs,
no,
arms.
No. He was selling the very, we began this program by talking about Revelation 12, 7, war in heaven, polemos, a political war. Mm-hmm. The thing that Satan is selling here is an idea. He's selling a picture. He's selling his version of reality. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that version of reality revolves around the fact that God is controlling, that God is manipulative, that God is coercive, that God is restrictive.
It's his own smear campaign.
It's a smear campaign. Now, here's a fascinating little thing here. I read an article several years ago by one of our, you know, premier theologians, and Dr. Richard Davidson, and he said, he's a, you know, brilliant Hebrew scholar, that the root word here, the word is, it's rekula. This word, by your trading, by your trafficking, is rekula. And he said the root word in the Hebrew is the very same as the root word for gossip, to lie, to tell a tall tale.
So we're engaged in a gossip war.
There's a gossip war. What he was selling was gossip. Mm-hmm. And that's where, you remember we said that Satan had things in his toolbox that were available to him. Mm-hmm. That God has truth, honesty, integrity, authenticity, transparency. No wonder God wants everything to be above the table. Yeah. Because God's character is only above board. Mm-hmm. Where Satan can be down here manipulating, creating, coercing, God says, no, let's, everything that's dark, let's turn the lights on. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Everything that's spoken in secret, let's say it out loud. Mm-hmm.
Mm. New Testament, same idea, all right?
Okay.
So fast forward from the traffic and trading of deceptive ideas in Ezekiel 28, we come to the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians, chapter 4.
Okay, I thought you were going to chapter 10.
Yeah, I could hear that in your voice.
Okay, okay.
Chapter 4, and starting with verse 3. Here's Satan in chapter 28 of Ezekiel. Here's Satan now being discussed by Paul. He says, but even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, emphasis, should shine on them. You catch that?
Of course
I did. So here, Paul is saying, I'll just summarize it. Paul is saying that the world is blinded on a mental level due to the lies that Satan has imposed upon the human mind. Mm-hmm. Notice that the devil is focused on minds, and he is called here the God of this age, and he blinds people's minds to the image of God. And Jesus is the infinite contrast. Jesus is the evidence that God is bringing to the table, so to speak. Jesus is the above the table full disclosure that God is bringing to the world, so that the light of the glory of the image of God should shine in to human minds and illuminate our thinking regarding the character of God. Verse 6.
Yes.
For it is the God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts, exactly where the great controversy is going on, to give the light, that is the information, the data, the insight of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the one through whom the truth about God's character is revealed, in contrast to the blinding deception of Satan, his trading, his traffic.
As to who God is.
Yeah, isn't that amazing?
Mm-hmm. Totally.
So you have a harmony here. Paul is thinking exactly like this description in Ezekiel 28.
And it says heart and knowledge. It seems to encompass both mental and emotional. It's like the way we mentally think about God and the way we feel about God.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I like that. Mind and heart.
Mind and heart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Something that we can't lose sight of here, and we just need to allow the sobriety of this point to impress itself upon our mind, and that is that Paul uses the strongest possible language here for Satan. He calls him the God, and if I'm not mistaken, it's the very same Greek word, theos, that's used for God in the rest of the New Testament.
Of
he calls
age.
Him the God of this age. In other words, he's saying that his power is so significant, his manipulative psychological power is so significant, that it is as if he is a godlike figure to those whose minds are blinded about who the true God is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's pervasive in his influence. 1 John chapter 5, I think it is, says that the whole world is under the sway,
the influence
of the wicked one.
Yeah.
Sway.
Now, that really makes sense when you look a little further on here in 2 Corinthians chapter 11.
Second Corinthians chapter 11. Okay,
let's go back to that, but Second Corinthians chapter 11 takes us back to Genesis, takes us back to the beginning of the deception, brings us all the way through Genesis to this conflict, and many times we read this in a very literal sense, but I want to read these verses to you and tell me what you think, because as I've been listening to this conversation, these verses have taken on a completely different meaning to me than they used to when I used to read these verses. I'll start in 2 Corinthians 11, and let's just begin with verse 1, and I'm reading here from the King James. Paul says, "Would to God you would bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me, for I am jealous over you," verse 2, "with godly jealousy. For I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. But," verse 3, "I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety,"
or craftiness, my Bible says,
"so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." Mm-hmm. Now notice this.
Got it.
"For if he that comes preaches another
Jesus,
whom you have not, whom we have not preached, or if you receive another spirit which you have not received, or another
gospel
which you have not accepted, you might well bear with him." Now notice this. And I'm just going to skip all of these verses now. I'm going to go to verse 13. "For such," those that bring these other gospel spirits and Jesus, "for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. For no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works." Now, I used to take this very literally. Oh, Satan's going to come. He's going to come as a minister of righteousness. But look at this in the context of our conversation. Satan came to Eve in the garden as a minister of righteousness, as an angel of light. We talked about
bringing
the pitchfork.
We talked about
yes.
God.
In other words, this is light. This is truth. This is good news. This is the gospel.
But
this,
his light is darkness.
His light is darkness.
This is so good, James.
So you've got this whole great controversy take. And what we're looking for in the world, just generally speaking, what we're looking for is we're looking for the pitchfork. We're looking for the horns. We're looking for the dark. And here it is. It's light. It's almost completely true, but yet there's one aspect of it that is false.
Yeah.
Which
is the
nature of deception, the mixing.
Yes.
Yeah. The mingling of truth.
And Paul is so concerned about this. He says, I am so concerned about this because, you know, back in the Garden of Eden,
it worked.
And we were perfect back then, and it worked. It was so subtle, it was so crafty, and it worked.
This scripture basically indicates, that's among other things, these are such great points, this scripture indicates that Satan has set up a religious system or a series of religious systems, and that he is masquerading in a religious garb, purporting to represent God through people
Christ.
Who are ministers, but in the process of their theology, they're misrepresenting the character of God in alignment with the original deception of Revelation of Genesis 3.
We're going to get there. We're going to get there. But the truth of the matter is a significant number of religions and even Christian perspectives that purport to be representing God are actually representing a picture of God, a caricature of God, that are nothing like what Scripture reveals.
Another Jesus.
We have to just be honest. Well, that's the thing I was going to say.
Another gospel.
He says here, another Jesus, a different spirit, a different gospel.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that something?
Yeah. Not everything that claims to be Christian is Christian. You can't just take that name as a label and stick it on things and suddenly it's biblical or suddenly it's Christian. Mm-hmm. Not that we're not sitting here at the table saying, oh, we have all the truth, but what we are saying is that that we are living in a matrix of deception. Mm-hmm. We are living in a place where the subtlety and the lines between truth and error can be.
Yeah.
So who then is our lighthouse? Mm-hmm. Who, through the fog, through the night, through the waves, what's the...
Jesus.
He says it's Jesus. Mm-hmm. God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shone in our hearts to give us the light, lighthouse, of the knowledge of who God is in the face of Jesus. Mm-hmm. He's the one that we've got to keep coming back to, such that we could just say this, and we're getting slightly ahead. If a picture that we have of God in our mind, whatever that picture is not harmonizable with the person that we see in the Gospels of Jesus, our picture of God is wrong.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Praise God. That is
He's the reference point.
In the 5 minutes that we have left, though, we got to get to 2 Corinthians chapter 10.
Okay.
Just back one page.
2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds, casting out arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Mm. I think, if I'm not mistaken, and James has it right here, I think the King James Version, instead of casting down arguments, it's casting down imaginations.
Yes, imaginations, or marginal reference, reasonings. Imaginations, reasonings.
Ideas, concepts.
Ideas. Yes. So the devil is engaged in a warfare against humanity in which he is leveraging ideas, arguments, images, imaginings, theological perspectives. He's trafficking in ideas, and he's aiming for the mind. He's aiming for the heart. He's planting distorted perceptions of the character of God. And we're called upon, all of us as believers, anybody who believes in God, in Christ, to do a kind of warfare.
Yeah, that's right.
A type of warfare.
I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that this program is a part of that warfare. Mm. Because the goal of this program, Table Talk, is for us and our listeners to learn to think biblically and clearly about who God is. Mm-hmm. So there's no weapons under the table. There's no knives here.
There is
but
a book.
This is very much an act of spiritual warfare.
It is.
Unmasking Satan and giving glory to God. Mm-hmm. God is awesome. God deserves our
praise. God is
beautiful.
He's beautiful.
Yeah.
Look at these verses, too. These verses actually add to this just a little bit. I don't know if we have time to do this, though.
We got 3 minutes. Go for it.
Second Peter chapter 2.
Talk fast. I've heard you do it.
Second Peter chapter 2. Again, summarizing, bringing it together, but tying in some of these words that we've read in Ezekiel chapter 28. But there were false prophets among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the truth shall be evil spoken of, and through covetousness they shall with feigned words make merchandise of you. God, Satan's been using words, wrong words, to make merchandise, to traffic his merchandise against God. They're going to make merchandise of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingers not, whose damnation slumbers not. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down. In other words, these verses are tying in not just what happened in heaven, not just what's going on in spiritual places, not just what is happening with Lucifer and his merchandise, but those who follow Christ, those who seek, as we are doing, to upend his plan, his purpose, his work, we're going to fall into that same category. We're going to receive opposition. We're going to find ourselves in a similar situation that all of God's faithful people have found themselves in the context of this great controversy.
It's a spiritual warfare, James, that takes the form of intellectual controversy. Mm-hmm. Who is God? What is a Christian? Who was Jesus? I mean, insurance policies and other things, acts of God.
Mm-hmm. What?
What? this God? The God of Scripture? The God of love? The God of goodness? The God... And you know, it's interesting, back in 2 Corinthians 10, where you read the line there about casting down, pulling down strongholds. Mm-hmm. Think this through. These strongholds have a stronghold on us and on our minds.
They're fortresses.
They are fortresses in the mind. This is who God really is. He's controlling. He's manipulative. This is who. And until, like Eve in the garden, until we think clearly about the love of God, the beauty of God, the goodness of God, these strongholds in our mind will elicit a whole host of behaviors that will bring shame, fear, guilt, broken relationships.
Ty, I think a good way to wrap this up, and you guys can piggyback on this real quick, but I think a great big picture frame is a statement that Paul makes in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 9, and we're aware of this statement.
You got about 30
that
seconds.
That we have been made a spectacle to the world, both to angels and to men. This whole picture of Job, we are Job. This little speck in the universe called planet Earth is Job. This is the theater here, and the entire universe is looking on.
Wow.
And how we live our lives and how we relate, how we think and feel about God will be the thing that God points to vindicate his character.
Wow. Yeah, praise God. Praise God. Wow.
To receive our free monthly newsletter and a list of Lightbearers resources, visit us online at lightbearers.org or call us toll free at 877-585-1111. You can also write to us at Lightbearers, 37457 Jasper Lowell Road, Jasper, Oregon, 97438.